friends. Welcome to Flosstube and Variety Show number 60. I'm Emily Williams in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. And today is Thursday, unusual for my recent video recordings, Thursday, October 20th. And thanks for joining me. So Flosstube is about cross-stitch and Variety Show is about something else. And I don't normally record on Thursday because recently I've had a pretty good routine of recording on Fridays when I'm in town. And since I've missed several weeks over the last few months, I didn't want to miss this week, but I'm going to be out of town tomorrow. So here we are on Thursday, and I find it's very discombobulating somehow for it to be a different day. But hopefully this will all be just as entertaining and fascinating as it always is. Anyway, enough nonsense. Let's talk about cross-stitch first. Flosstube has to do with cross-stitch. Under the roof of blue Ionian weather. Now, I show you this and I'm sure it's impossible to discern a difference most times, right? It will be impossible today too, but I'm working mainly on this woman right there. And I have a little story to tell about floss in just a moment. And I didn't take it out of the hoop because it's perfectly positioned and it's sort of awkward to get it in out of the hoop, but you can begin to see the shape of her and her head. Her face is here, and actually from a distance, I can discern her face a little better than I can when I'm working on it. So it'll be interesting as that comes into focus more, so to speak. Now I can hold this as close as I want to the camera, and you will not be able to see what I'm about to talk about. And I have a picture that I'll insert that shows a closer close-up of what I'm talking about, but I don't think you'll be able to see it. So why am I talking about it, you may wonder. Well, so this floss right here, 3823, it is pale yellow, as you see. And in this cross-stitch, there is almost no pale yellow. In fact, in 72,000 stitches, at plus a few, you know, 72,200 or something stitches, there are 17 stitches in this color. And I have done 15 of them, so I lack 2 stitches of this color to be, before I can say I've completed a color in this giant piece. And I'll hold this up again. You can tell that I put that in there, can't you? No, of course you can't. I mean, so here's the thing about full coverage, especially this designer, Golden Kite. Yes, that's what it's called, Golden Kite. The shading and the reproduction of the nuances of the work of art being depicted or being reproduced is unique among cross-stitch reproducers, I would say. The other one that comes close is Heaven and Earth Designs. But I don't think they use blends in that. I think they just use many individual colors of thread. So this uses individual colors of thread, a lot of them plus blends, and this color right here. Now, the reason this is important is not only because it's, I'm almost done with it, I almost have a zero, is because I didn't have it, and I debated about whether to just fill in the stitches, the 17 stitches that are supposed to be this color, with a neighboring color. I mean, what difference could it make? So I looked at that color in my DMC floss card, which, as you recall, I showed you this few months ago. It is the actual threads. It's not just pictures of the colors. And it has all of them. Let me just say, this is a great thing to browse through. I mean, look at it, it's huge. But the DMC floss ends here, and that 30, 3823 is somewhere there on that page with the yellowy brown colors. And I debated about whether to just pick something from my collection of threads that I already have that would be close. And I decided not to. And the reason I decided not to is because this woman is sitting on, she's wearing a white dress and she's sitting on a white marble step. So she already is pretty blendy. And her dress is made of the same colors of thread and combinations of colors, the blends, as the marble around her is. And the yellow is unique. And so I decided, you know, I'm going to go ahead and make the effort to get this thread and do that. So I did. Will it make a difference? I have to believe that it will. I just do because I made the effort. So therefore, of course, it makes a difference. Okay, enough of that. This is sampler number 193 by 2x2 Stitch Art. And I have made it up to the almost the very top, and I'm heading this way. I'm about over here, and you can see this. So I've done just one row. There are three rows of solid stitching border that little curlicue sticks up in, and the corner motif stick up into also. And there are not a lot of reasons I wanted to get to the top of this. One is because I just want to get to the top of it. And the other is because that there's a lot of just straight stitching in that border that I think will be on the boring side. So that's the second reason. So I want to get started on it so that I don't end up with that's all that's left and I have to force myself to do it. And then, so these little motifs are incomplete. Don't think that they're weird shaped T shapes up there. And the third reason is because I'm gonna be gone this weekend and I think that I might be able to take this with me to work on. And I wanted to be able to head up to that section pretty easily because it would be easier to do that while chatting with people, with my friends that I'm going to be with than to try to work on regular standard cross stitch that has a lot of counting and detail. Now, one of my barriers to taking cross stitch anywhere is that what I use to cross stitch is this, which is on a rolling stand, multiple adjustable, and it's a 4X magnifier, I think, with a little dot, you know what those are, that has a small area of increased magnification. I rarely use that dot. And it is a very bright light. And so I joke that I need operating room lights and I need, super duper magnifying glass in order to do any cross stitch. Well, I do really need bright light. That is true. And I will say, especially for something like Under the Roof of Blue Ionian Weather, because it's just hard to see the paleness against the pale fabric and, like, you know, next to each other, next to the other stitches and so on. But I was thinking about going to that Great British Sampler weekend next year and decided I would need something for that. And so I got this. This is called a Halo Go. It was recommended by a few people, including my friend Leslie, and it has a lot of adjustments possible. This twists and this goes up and down. I mean, it doesn't go up and down. It creates a different angle. And the base is very nice and heavy, and it has a little foamy thing on it. And it has two layers of adjustment in the light. And it folds up, and it's rechargeable. So I got this. Now, I hesitated because it's only a 2.5 magnifying section of the main thing, and it's smaller. The magnification area is smaller. And I was concerned that I wouldn't find it very comfortable to use. Also, just the height of it it's not adjustable in height, so you have to sort of adjust to it instead of adjusting it to you, which can create some ergonomic problems. However, I've used it a few hours working, and I particularly used it on the sampler 193 right here, because I will take that with me this weekend and see how it works. It'll be a trial run for the retreat. Now, I also believe that when you're going on a cross-stitch retreat, what I've heard is you take projects to work on and you get a project, at least one, as part of the retreat. That's one of the things you're doing, is everybody gets a special project and you work on it. It's sort of a shared experience part of the whole event. And nobody stitches. You know, everybody stitches 16 stitches and the whole time that they're gone. So I'm not too concerned about it, really. But it would be nice to have some flexibility and portability to my cross-stitch capacity. So we'll see how that works. One thing I will say, having used it a little bit, I'm skeptical of the statement that it will run at the full brightness for 8 hours. I don't know about that. I mean, I haven't tried it for 8 hours straight, or even 8 hours in a day or two, but I'll let you know. And if any of you has one of these, which I know at least one of my usual viewers does have one, I'd love to know what you think of the longevity of the charge of it. And since we're going to be in England, we're going to have some an adapter for power. It might actually charge faster there, because I think we have 110 and they have 200 or something. I don't know. Things are different over there across the pond. Okay, let me go on to a few other things, which I want to give you an update on Winter Rose Manor. I showed you this last time. When this was first released, it was stitched by almost everyone in the world, but I wasn't one of those people. But I'm going to stitch it soon. Now, I talked last week about the challenge of getting the fabric and the threads, and Leslie, my friend, with whom I'm going to England next year, reminded me that Hobby House Needleworks will sell you anything. So I went and checked, and they had this fabric, which is Brenda's Brew by R&R Reproductions. Brenda's Brew is a recommended fabric, 36 count Brenda's Brew. They did have it in stock, and they would do a custom cut, but they only had the smallest piece they had that was one of their standard pieces, and they said, you know, they would give a dimension like a fat quarter or custom. And I didn't explore thoroughly, but they didn't have the fat eighth or the fat quarter. The fat quarter would have been the right size for a custom cut of this, because it needs to be 16 by 16. And then they had the fat half and the whole yard. And this is not inexpensive, this stuff. This is not low cost. So I didn't get it at first. And then I did get it. I did decide to order it, so I ordered a half yard. I mean, it's an extravagance in a way. But on the other hand, this is, I think, a beautiful picture. And having it on the right color linen, I think, is going to make all the difference. And I'm a big one for switching things up and making my own decisions in some cases. And in some cases, it's worked out very well. And in other cases, I haven't been that thrilled. So this time I'm going to do it the way it's been designed. And so mine will look like everybody else's, but that's all right. I mean, it's interesting that reproduction samplers is a thing, isn't it? Where designers or people find antique samplers and they even purchase them. They go on eBay or to auctions and so forth and purchase them. and then they chart them so that I can stitch it. So I'm going to, so I stitch a sampler that a little girl stitched in 1863. And I'm fine with that. And for some reason we do not. It's just my problem. It's not you, it's me. Object to stitching this exactly as the designer designed it. Well, that's ridiculous, that's silly. So I'm gonna do it that way. I'm reproducing Brenda Gervais' Winter Rose Manor this winter. I'm gonna start it in January 1st. And I can say that with confidence because I have tracked down, I think I've tracked down all the thread. I had to go to 3 different places, or maybe it's 4 different places to get it. Go to, meaning online. So I have these two, which this is conch, C-O-N-C-H, is that how you say that? Isn't that funny? That's a very common word. I don't know how to pronounce it. Is it conch? 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 I don't know. And wood rose. So this is Weeks Dye Works, and this is Gentle Arts. The big quiz was finding Gentle Arts roasted marshmallow, which I did finally find at an Etsy shop. Now, let me just tell you, let me commend the Cottage needle to you, this shop. And I'm commending them because, first of all, it came fast and it was beautifully packaged, these two in a little Ziploc bag. And then she says, as always, please find attached one of my favorite needles. And here is a needle, which I have been curious about this brand. It's a Bowen size 26. So I will definitely give that a try. And of course, if I like it, I can buy some more from her. So I think that's great. Now, the other interesting thing is I'm now holding in my hands my first cotton overdyed floss that I've ever had. I don't really know how to use it. This seems to be cut into lengths, but it's doubled up. So I suppose I untie it from the card and take out what I want, and I don't really know. This is one length that's been looped into the card. That is, this is five 1-yard lengths right here. This is 1 5-yard length. I don't know, do I wind this on a bobbin? I suppose I can do anything I want, can't I? Because there are no police. So anyway, I commend that shop to you. As more shops respond to my orders, I'll show you. And I don't normally have a big section on acquisitions, as you will know if you've watched my videos, but I do want to show you Fox and Rabbit. Oh, I shouldn't show you my address, I suppose. Fox and Rabbit, look at the packaging here. Isn't that nice? There's their logo. I've mentioned them before. They are the fabric dyers and cross-stitch designers and reproducers, sampler reproduction people from Australia. I'm a member of their Patreon. And at my tier of the Patreon, once a quarter, we get a fat quarter of their hand-dyed fabric. And this is called White Clay, which I'm really happy to have this. It is a really nice neutral. And this is a fat quarter of 18 count Aida. And I have some thoughts on it already, ideas of things I might want to stitch on it. But it's a really nice, extremely neutral, if you will. I mean, it doesn't head toward, I suppose if it heads anywhere, it might head ever so slightly toward tan, but like 2 pixels toward tan. I don't know what the term is. Really nice. Looking forward to using that. And also the other thing is quarterly, a project bag. And this is really pretty, I think. And it has a magnetic closure here and pretty inside. It's, you know, it'll be really nice to put something in. It's, you know, padded, it has some batting to it. And she makes them, Karen makes the project bags. So that is fun. I will, supposedly quarterly, and this one was delayed. They had problems with shipping and then getting, there's still supply chain issues in the world. And it's affecting cross-stitch fabric fabric coming out of Zweigart a lot. It really is, apparently. I've heard this from more than one floss tube that I watch. Okay, variety show. Wonder what I'm going to talk about today. Well, so I was going to say years ago. Can't be years ago. Months ago, I maybe talked about classic games, the best classic games. I don't know if I did or not. I should really go back through my videos and be more careful about cataloging what I've already talked about. So if I've already talked about this, my apologies. If I talked about it long enough ago that I don't really remember, I may have something a little bit different to say. Don't know, but here's what I'm going to say. Classic games. There are a lot of new games in the world. Every month, probably, there are, I don't know, 40 new games out there that you could buy and try with your gaming friends. Board games, card games. I'm thinking of that mainly, not electronic games, although there's certainly a lot of new ones of those too. But sometimes the classics prove themselves to be worthwhile. And I'm going to commend four games to you today that are classics. The first two I'm going to talk about are card games. These are games that use a standard deck of cards, and you have heard of them. You maybe haven't played them, or maybe your grandparents played them. But the first one is Gin Rummy. Why is it called Gin Rummy? I'm not sure. I should have looked that up. That would have been a helpful little tidbit, wouldn't it? Maybe I'll look it up and put it in the description box below. But Gin Rummy is a type of rummy. There are other types, but Gin Rummy is characterized by these things. One is it's for two players only. There are no three or four player versions of it. And secondly, you do not play down your cards as you get books, as you get sets of cards. You hold your whole hand in your hand, and then you lay it down all at once, which means that you aren't playing off of each other's cards either, except in the final scoring. And the goal of Gin Rummy, you go gin on a hand if you can lay down all 10 of your cards. I think you must have a discard. You have 10 cards in your hand. You draw a card, and then you discard a card. That's the process of the game. And if you have all of your cards into books, either three of a kind or a run of a suit in a suit, you know, three, four, five, six of hearts or whatever. If you have all of your cards that are accounted for in those books, then you may lay down. And I think you have to have a discard. So you lay down 10 cards and you discard your 11th, one that you drew. And if you can do that with all your cards down, then it's called gin. Going gin and you get a bonus of 25 points plus some means of scoring. I don't remember what it is. And in that case, your opponent, any cards that they have in their hand that are not part of books also become your points. You can also go out, you can knock, as it's called, where you're going out, where you have 10 points or less unmatched, unbooked. You can do that. And what that means is your opponent can lay down, can lay down his complete sets and lay off his incomplete sets on yours. And you only get the points that are the difference between yours, between what he has left, I think. But anyway, regardless of the scoring, it's a very good two-player game. Usually, two players who are pretty good at the game can play a complete game. You go up to 100 in maybe five hands, and it might take less than half an hour. And that, I think, is a mark of a good two-player card game, something you could play on your lunch hour with somebody. Another fantastic, I think maybe the best two-player card game ever, is the game of cribbage. Now, cribbage is played with a board as the scoreboard, and you can buy these really fancy. This is burled maple, And, you know, this is very typical. This is a traditional cribbage board in that it has groups of 10 holes, five up, five down, and a place in the middle to put pegs for scoring, for keeping track of the number of games. And then there's two sides of it. So this is my side and this is my opponent's side. You set the board like this between yourselves and you use pegs, which I have some pegs in here to mark your score. Oh, I don't have the ones that were originally sent with it because I bought fancy pegs because I'm a cribbage nerd. But, so these are, I'm trying not to spill the pegs on the floor. These are pegs, use pegs to mark your score. Now, cribbage board can be used to score a lot of games. It isn't only for cribbage. But if you are going to play cribbage, it's much, much, much easier to play the game if you have a cribbage board to score. Now, cribbage boards are, I think, one of the most available souvenir type things that there are. Now, this isn't a souvenir one, but this is just another style. In that traditional cribbage board that I just showed you, you go around the board twice. In this one, it's set up so you only go around once. And this is set up to be able to be played for three-player cribbage. That is three different scoring tracks and also keeping track of all kinds of statistics on the board. But it's the same idea. And then finally, as I was saying, souvenirs. You go to a place, you can buy a souvenir cribbage board. This is a cribbage board in the shape of a canoe. A friend of mine gave me this. This isn't actually a souvenir from anywhere. It was purchased at a store, but it's a la souvenir. So that's cribbage. Cribbage is a game. It has been over time. I've been aware of it as popular in the military and popular with the generation that is my parents and older. I do know people who are my age and younger who play cribbage. And I have taught some people to play cribbage, but it's not as common. Now, there is a cribbage board game version. This one, I'm not aware of another one, but this is called King's Cribbage, and it's sort of a Scrabble idea where you lay tiles that represent the values of the cards, and your goal is to score more points through normal cribbage scoring by laying tiles than your opponents. It's not as good a game as cribbage, the actual game. But there it is. And now where am I gonna put that without knocking a bunch of things on the floor? Now, the other game category that I wanna talk about is backgammon. Now this is a backgammon board. This has been beaten up, this particular case, but very commonly you get them in a case like this. This is the board, and you have the pieces, they're called stones, you have dice cups, and usually these come with rules, which is good because a lot of people don't know how to play. Backgammon is a very ancient game. It is thousands of years old, I think. I think it's been, backgammon boards of some variety or other have been discovered as long ago as a long time ago in the in India and the areas like that, I think is where it was developed. It is believed. Now there's another version of backgammon. Now backgammon is a two-player game. It is the best two-player board game. It has a really interesting mix of luck and skill. The best player will always win, will win more times over time. I don't know if you can hear the sirens in the background. Sorry if I'm a little distracted, if I seem a little distracted. But luck can also take you somewhere in backgammon. So normally matches are played best 3 out of 5 or 4 out of 7, something like that. You can also double, which is sort of saying, I bet you that I'm gonna win. And if I do, I get double the points. And if you win, you get double the points. I mean, if I lose, you get double the points. So there's that kind of stuff going on in it too. And a modern version of a backgammon type game, which is for 2 to 4 players, is Parcheesi. And that's a game I played as a child. It is a backgammon game in that you roll dice in order to move around the board, and you can affect your opponent by landing on their men. And your goal is to get your pieces into home, which is the same goal as backgammon, the original game. But you only have 4 pieces in Parcheesi, and you have 15 pieces in backgammon. But the board is longer in Parcheesi, and it's only 24 spaces in backgammon. So they're different, but the same idea, and both excellent, excellent games. Really excellent. Now, one more thing I forgot to mention when I was talking about acquisitions is I received, oh goodness, this is heavy, Jenny's Countdown to Christmas 2022. Now, this is very cute. It looks like a traveling case, and it has stickers on it as if I had visited the shops in Hamilton, Missouri, and it has this tag that says, with love from Hamilton, Merry Christmas from your friends at Missouri Star Quilt Company, Main Shop, and so on. Very cute. And as I say, it's not light. That is not supposed to be open until December 1st. And I point out it's October 20th. So on the one hand, good for them. No question about it arriving on time. And on the other hand, 40 days of waiting. Actually, 41 days of waiting, because October has 31 days. What in the world? Okay, one more thing. I meant to lead with this, but I forgot. My quilt at the state fair. So I actually got a hint of this from friends of ours who visited the fair on Friday. The fair opened last Thursday, and they visited on Friday. And I received a texted photo from my friend who, it just showed the quilt and it showed a red ribbon, a second place ribbon. And I replied, what? Is that ribbon attached to my quilt? And it was. So my quilt won second place, which I am flabbergasted is too mild a word. I'm really surprised, because I just don't think it's, I mean, I think it's a beautiful quilt, but I think the quilting in particular is not outstanding. I think it's very typical of, it's very authentic as to hand quilted quilts that Byron's grandmother did, for example, but it is not excellent. It's good. It's fine. It's good. It's pretty. It's effective. I hope my friend likes it. But I'm very pleased to have won second prize. And this, of course, makes me think, oh, I'm going to definitely enter a hand-quilted quilt next year. So stay tuned. If I do enter a hand-quilted quilt next year, I don't know. I've already been musing about what design would be best. I don't know. It's sort of hard to know what about that quilt attracted the attention of the judges. Why did they like it? Perhaps because it's a tumbling block. So maybe I should do another tumbling block quilt and quilt it differently. And I might say, oh, I don't think I can do another tumbling block. I don't think I have one in me. At least not as soon as next year. So we'll see. Okay, I've gone on a while, a little longer than I thought I would today. I hope that you found something of interest in what I've talked about today, and I hope you'll have a great weekend. I'm going to be gone into the North Carolina mountains, where I think it's close to the peak of color. It's a little crazy to go there at leaf peeping season, because the entire world, all of the Southeast, goes to the mountains in leaf season. But we're going to be staying at a friend's house. I'm going with a group of friends who comprise my cooking group. And so we're going to eat at a nice restaurant and hang out, maybe do a little shopping. We'll be at Swannanoa, near Brevard, near Black Mountain, you know, that part of the mountains, near Asheville, North Carolina. And so that's where I'll be. I will not be doing much cross stitch unless I can get something done on that red sampler number 193. Such a catchy name. But I doubt I'll do much, really. That's probably not how I'll find myself spending my time. I plan to do, I was going to say I plan to do another video next Friday. I think it will be Thursday again, because we're going to be gone overnight next Friday. Yeah. Suddenly, with things, I'll say, opening up. Let me put it differently. People think that things are opening up after the biggest crises sections of the pandemic. What that means is not necessarily that there is less COVID out there. In fact, there may be more COVID out there, but that people's expectations are now that you will come. If they say, please come, you'll say, of course. Or you will want to go and you'll make the choice to go. So I'm going on this weekend, for example. It seems a little, I have not eaten indoors in a restaurant that many times in the past 2.5 years, but I'll be eating indoors at least one restaurant this time. This trip that we're going to make on October 28th and 29th is to see our nephew play football. And we'll stay in a hotel, which I think is fine. We'll be eating indoors in restaurants. We'll be with people, although mostly outdoors, and hopefully we'll have nice weather for that game. It's his senior night. He's a senior. He plays high school football. Anyway, that's what we're going to be doing next Friday, and I think in order to make it to the game, we'll have to leave too early for me to think I could do a video and edit it and upload it onto YouTube. So probably it'll be Thursday again next week. And that also means I won't have much stitching to show. I don't know. I would love to know your thoughts. Should I make a video with less to talk about, with less cross-stitch progress to talk about, and find other things to talk about? Or should I skip it? I'd love to know your thoughts. Now this has really gone on long. Okay, I'm really done now. I'm going to be quiet. Many blessings to you, friends.